لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
باب يحشى في وجوه المداحين تراب. حدثنا علي بن عبد الله قال حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي قال حدثنا سفيان بن سعيد عن حبيب بن ابي ثابت المجاهد عن ابي معمر قال قام رجل يثني على امير من الامراء فجعل المحداد يحشي في وجهه التراب وقال أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أن نحشي في وجوه المداحين التراب.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue with the explanation of Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari رحمه الله تعالى. And we begin the chapter Babu Yuhtha fi Wujuh al-Maddahin al-Turab, the chapter that you throw earth on the face of those who extensively praise. That you throw earth on the face of those who extensively praise. Now in this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala begins with the hadith which is collected in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. So he says, قَامَ رَجُلٌ يُثْنِي عَلَىٰ أَمِيرٍ مِّنَ الْأُمَرَىٰ. A man, he stood up and he began to praise a leader from the leaders. And in other narrations we find that this leader was Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. فَجَعَلَ الْمِقْدَادِ يَحْثِي فِي وَجْهِهِ التُّرَابِ. So al-Miqdad radiallahu anhu began to throw earth on his face. وَقَالَ, and he said, أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَن نَحْثِيَ فِي وُجُوهِ الْمَدَّاحِينَ التُّرَابِ. So Al-Miqdad radiallahu anhu, he threw earth on his face and then he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to throw earth on the face of the maddahin. Now what is the maddahin? Maddahin, these are the people who extensively praise. So they excessively praise people and they cross the limits of praising, and some of them, this becomes part of their lifestyle that whenever they see certain people, they will praise them in order to receive something back from them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam discouraged this. And as we took in the previous narrations, in the previous lesson, that excessively praising someone is like cutting his neck off, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. Because this will make a person feel that he is better than he actually is. And this could make him increase in his pride and his arrogance, and this could make him decrease in his sincerity and his actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited us from praising people in their faces. And those who excessively praise, the Sahaba used to take this hadith literally, and not all of them, because there was a dispute amongst the Sahaba with regards to the hadith. Is it literal that we actually take the turab, the earth, and we throw it on their faces? This was a view of a number of Sahaba. And in this hadith we find that it was the view of Al-Miqdad radiallahu anhu wa arda. And some of the other Sahaba said this is a way, a meaning, a phrase in the Arabic language to actually rebuke them. But we find, so there is a practice from the Sahaba where they used to throw earth on their faces. And the reason they would do this is because a person is harming their reputation or harming the individual who they are praising. Because he will decrease in his certainty, in his sincerity, and his actions. So it is as if the person is making him dirty and filthy after he was pure. So likewise, we will throw mud on their faces or earth on their faces to make them appear as if they are dirty after they were pure. So this was the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is how some of the Sahaba, they understood the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We also find from this hadith how the Sahaba, they used to try and follow the sunnah to the best of their ability, irrespective of what the people around them would say. If you were to do this literally, then how would the people around you act towards you? They may dislike you, they may turn against you. But this did not affect the Sahaba, the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that whoever excessively praises someone, then throw earth on his face. The Sahabi, they did this. The Sahaba, they did this. And then they mentioned the narration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا موسى بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا حماد بن حماد عن علي بن الحكم عن عطاء بن أبي رباح أن رجلا كان يمدح رجلا عند ابن عمر فجعل ابن عمر يحثو تراب نحو فيه وقال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا رأيتم المداحين فاحشوا بوجوههم التراب.
Now Imam al-Bukhari mentions the second narration in this chapter. He said, أَنَّ رَجُلًا كَانَ يَمْدَحُ رَجُلًا عِنْدَ ابْنِ عُمَرٍ. A man was praising another man in the presence of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma. فَجَعَلَ ابْنُ عُمَرَ يَحْثُ التُّرَابَ نَحْوَ فِيهِ. So Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he began to throw earth towards his mouth. وَقَالَ, and he said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الْمَدَّاحِينَ فَحْثُوا فِي وُجُوهِهِمُ التُّرَابِ, that if you see the people excessively praising, then throw earth at their faces. So again, this shows you that even the understanding of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma from this hadith is the literal understanding where you will actually take earth and throw it on the face of the person who is excessively praising someone else. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا أبو عوانة عن أبي بشر عن عبد الله بن شقيق عن رجاء بن أبي رجاء عن محجم الأسلمي قال رجاء أقبلت مع محجم ذات يوم حتى دعينا إلى مسجد أهل البصرة فإذا بريدة الأسلمي على باب من أبواب المسجد جالس قال وكان في المسجد رجل يقال له سكب يطيل الصلاة فلما انتهينا إلى باب المسجد وعليه بردة وكان بريدة صاحبا مزاحات فقال يا محجم أتصلي كما يصلي سكب فلم يرد عليه محجم فرجع قال محجم إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أخذ بيدي فانطلقنا نمشي حتى صعدنا أحد فأشرق على المدينة فقال ويل أمها من قرية يتركها أهلها كأعمار ما تكون يأتيها الدجال ويجد على كل باب من أبوابها ملكا فلا يدخلها ثم إن حضر حتى إذا كنا في المسجد رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم رجلا يصلي ويسجد ويركع فقال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم من هذا فقلت أقريه فقلت يا رسول الله هذا فلان وهذا فلان فقال أمسك لا تسمعه فتهلكه قال فانطلق يمشي حتى إذا كان عند حجره لكنه نقض يديه ثم قال إن خير دينكم أيسره ثلاثة.
Now Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith of Mihjan al-Aslami radiyallahu an. And he says, قال رجاء, that رجاء, he said, and رجاء is not very well known. He's not very well known, but the ulama of hadith did not weaken this hadith because Abdullah ibn Shaqiq, he narrates from رجاء. And because of the position of Abdullah ibn Shaqiq narrating from رجاء, it strengthens the narration of رجاء, because Abdullah ibn Shaqiq wouldn't have narrated from him if he was not known. So Raja is with Mihjan al-Aslami, who is a Sahabi. So he says, Raja said, أَقْبَلْتُ مَعَ مِحْجَنْ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ حَتَّى انْتَهَيْنَا إِلَىٰ مَسْجِدِ أَهْلِ الْبَصْرَةِ. I went with Mihjan radiallahu anhu one day until we came to the masjid of the people of Basra. فَإِذَا بُرَيْدَةُ الْأَسْلَمِيُّ عَلَى بَابٍ مِّنْ أَبْوَابِ الْمَسْجِدِ جَالِسٌ. And we found that Burayda al-Aslami radiallahu anhu, another Sahabi, he was sitting at the door of one of the doors of the masjid. قَالَ وَكَانَ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ رَجُلٌ يُقَالُ لَهُ سَكَبَ. And they said, in the masjid there was a man, his name was Sakaba. And this is Sakaba ibn al-Harith, who was also a Sahabi. So here Raja is mentioning that he and Mihjan radiallahu an, they went to a masjid in Basra. And at one of the doors of the masjid, they found Burayda radiallahu an sitting. And in the masjid there was a man, he was another Sahabi, his name was Sakaba, يُطِيلُ الصَّلَاةِ, he was prolonging his salah. So this is a voluntary prayer that he was praying, but he was really prolonging this prayer. فَلَمَّا انْتَهَيْنَا إِلَىٰ بَابِ الْمَسْجِدِ, وعليه بردة. And this man Saqaba was wearing a cloak. And when we came to the door of the masjid, وَكَانَ بُرَيْدَ صَاحِبُ صَاحِبَ مُزَاحَاتِ. And we met Burayda, and he was a very humorous person. فَقَالَ يَا مِحْجَنَ. So he said, "Oh Mihjan, أَتُصَلِّي كَمَا يُصَلِّي Saqaba." He said, "Oh Mihjan, do you pray just like Saqaba prays?" Meaning he's inquiring now. So one Sahabi is asking another Sahabi about the action of another Sahabi. Burayda is asking Mihjan, "Do you pray as Saqaba prays? Is it permissible to pray the prayer in this manner? Or to lengthen the prayer in this manner?" He wants to find out the ruling about this. Has he heard anything from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding this? فَلَمْ يَرُدَّ عَلَيْهِ مِحْجَنْ. So Mihjan didn't reply with anything. وَرَجَعْ. Then Burayda, he asked again. قَالَ مِحْجَنْ. So Mihjan, he said, إِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَخَذَ بِيَدِي. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took me by my hand. فَانْتَلَقْنَا نَمْشِي حَتَّى صَعِدْنَا أُحُدًا. Then we moved and we walked until we ascended Mount Uhud. فَأَشْرَفَ عَلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. And we were looking at and overlooking Medina. Just taking a look at this part of the hadith now, for what we have taken so far. We find that one Sahabi, he met another Sahabi. And he was curious about an action of another Sahabi. So he asked about it. And this Sahabi now mentions a story that happened with him with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be with his companions. And remember, he was the leader of the believers, and not just the believers, but the leader of mankind sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would take his companions by their hands, and he will walk with them in Medina. And this companion specifically, he ascended Mount Uhud with him, and he showed him Medina sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the etiquette of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the love that he showed his companions, and the love that won his companions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like the disbelievers, they were jealous of how much the companions used to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this jealousy, it made some of them embrace Islam, because they wanted to be loved by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they wanted to have that love in their hearts for him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with his companions. So he took Mihjan radiallahu anhu to Mount Uhud, and they ascended Mount Uhud together. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَيْلُ أُمِّهَا مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ يَتْرُكُهَا أَهْلُهَا كَأَعْمَرَ مَا تَكُونَ. He's saying that this is from the mother of the cities. It is from the greatest of the cities, yet the people will leave it. Yet the people will leave the city. Because there is hardship in living in Medina. And when the Sahaba, they first came to Medina, they found great hardship in the weather of Medina. That there were illnesses in Medina to the extent that Bilal radiallahu anh and Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, they were cursing the Quraysh for expelling them from Mecca because they drove them to Medina, a land full of illnesses. So when this news reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he began to make dua, and he said, "Oh Allah, transfer the illnesses of Medina to Juhfa, and make my companions love Medina the way they love Mecca and even more." So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala transferred the illnesses away from Medina, and he made his companions love Medina more than they even loved Mecca. But Medina has hardship. And even the people that live in Medina today say it has hardship in living in there, for those that reside there and live there. But there are great benefits and bounties of living in Medina. Just like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَمُوتَ بِالْمَدِينَةِ فَلْيَمُوتْ بِهَا فَإِنِّي أَشْفَعُ لِمَنْ يَمُوتُ بِهَا. Whoever of you is able to die in Medina, then let him die in Medina. Because indeed, I will intercede for those who die in Medina. So a special intercession from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for those who die in Medina. And as narrated by Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih, Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to make this dua to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Allahumma arzuqni shahadatan fi sabilik, waj'al mawti fi baladi rasulik. That, oh Allah, allow me to have martyrdom in your path, and allow my death to be in the land of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In some of the musannafat, it's mentioned that people will say to Umar, how can you make this dua that you are going to be a martyr in Medina when there are no disbelievers in Medina? How are you going to be a martyr in Medina? So Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, if I have made this dua, Allah will accept it. It shows you the yaqeen of the Sahaba. When they make dua to Allah, they know with certainty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept their duas. So what does this hadith mean, that whoever is able to die in Medina, let him die in Medina? Because no one can choose where they live. So no one can choose where they die, sorry. The scholars mentioned that this means a person should try and spend as much time in Medina as possible. So when death strikes, he is in Medina. So if he's able to reside in Medina, he should reside in it, and he should only leave it for a need. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never used to leave Medina. He only used to leave Medina for jihad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or for Hajj and Umrah. And there was no other time that he would leave Medina sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he would reside in Medina, and he would only leave Medina for jihad, and only leave Medina when he was going for Mecca, for Umrah, or for Hajj sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when a person resides in Medina and spends his entire life in Medina, it is highly likely that he will be there when the angel of death comes. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he was killed as a martyr in Medina, and his dua was accepted. And even after all of the virtues we know of Medina, and the bounties and the blessings of Medina, the Prophet ﷺ still mentioned that the people, they will leave it. They will leave Medina and they will leave it empty. They will leave it with only a few people living there. And that's why in another narration, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that Yemen would open. And the people will go to Yemen with their families and their provisions. وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ But Medina is better for them if only they knew. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, and Sham would open, and Iraq would open, and he mentioned a number of places. And the people will go to these places. وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ But Medina is better for them if only that they knew. So Medina has great bounties and great virtues in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here the Prophet ﷺ is showing this Sahabi Medina. And he said, this is from the mother of the cities. It is from them. Because the mother of the cities is which city? Which city? Is the mother of the cities. Mecca, Umm al-Qura. That's why it's called Umm al-Qura, the mother of the villages, the mother of the cities. So the mother of the city is Mecca. And from the greatest cities, and from the mothers of the cities is also Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ said, this is from the mother of the cities, yet the people will leave it empty. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, يَأْتِي هَالدَّجَّال And the Dajjal will come to it. فَيَجِدُ عَلَى كُلِّ بَابٍ مِّنْ أَبْوَابِهَا مَلَكًا فَلَا يَدْخُلُهَا The Dajjal will come to Medina and it will find an angel at every gate of Medina and it will not be able to enter Medina. So Allah Jalla wa Ala will protect, Allah Jalla wa Ala will protect the people of Medina from the greatest test, which is the test of Dajjal. And this test is going to be so severe that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was afraid of this test. And he used to tell the Sahaba and he used to warn them against the Dajjal. And that's why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his salah, in every salah, he would make dua that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala protects him from the trial of the Dajjal. Before the Taslim, he Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would make the dua that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala protects him from the trial of the Dajjal. ثُمَّ انْحَدَرَ حَتَّى إِذَا كُنَّا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ Then the Sahabi, he said, then we descended. Him and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam until they came to the masjid. رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا يصلي ويسجد ويركع. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saw a man performing salah and he was making sajda and he was making ruku'. فقال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من هذا? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, who is this? فأخذت أطريه. I began to praise him. And أطريه means praise him excessively. فقلت يا رسول الله هذا فلان وهذا فلان. I said, oh Messenger of Allah, this is such and such person and this is such and such person. Excessively praising him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أمسك لا تسمعه فتهلكه. He said, stop. Do not let him hear this or you will make him perish. Just like we took in the previous chapters. قال فانطلق يمشي. This man, he said, then I moved. حتى إذا كان or we moved حتى إذا كان عند حجره until we came to the house of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم لكنه نفض يديه ثم قال the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم dusted himself off and then he said إن خير دينكم أيسره إن خير دينكم أيسره إن خير دينكم أيسره that the best of your religion is the easiest the best of your religion is the easiest the best of your religion is the easiest firstly before mentioning and explaining the last part of the hadith What is the point of evidence from this hadith? Imam Bukhari mentioned this hadith in the chapter Babu Yuhtham fi wujuhi al-maddahin al-turab The chapter that those who excessively praise, you throw turab on their face, earth on their face. So what is the point of evidence in this chapter? Can anyone derive the point of evidence? No. The point of evidence. No.
Praises him excessively because he saw him praying.
But did the Prophet throw earth on his face?
No. He throws a shakes his hand and busts.
No.
You see, if you praise someone, you don't let them listen to your reason.
Now this is the actual point of evidence though for the chapter. The point of evidence is Imam Bukhari uses this hadith as an evidence that not everyone's face is thrown, you do not throw turab on everyone's face who praises. Only some people who praise, turab is thrown on their faces. And some people who praise, turab is not thrown on their faces. Now this man, he praised him, he praised this other man, the Prophet ﷺ rebuked him for praising him. And he said, do not let him hear your praise or you will perish him. But he did not throw turab on his face. So it shows you not everyone who praises, turab is thrown on their face. When someone excessively praises someone in front of their face, and it will harm and damage the person he is praising, this person deserves to be, this person, it is deserving that this person, turab is thrown on his face. But if someone praises someone behind their back, and it's not going to cause that person a fitna, we rebuke him, and we say, make sure you do not tell him and do it in front of him, but we do not throw turab on his face. So not everyone who praises, earth is thrown on their face. This is the point of evidence where Imam al-Bukhari mentioned this hadith in this chapter. The Prophet ﷺ concluded the hadith by saying, the best of you are those whose religion is the easiest. And this was an evidence that he was mentioning to the other sahabi who asked about the salah of Sakbah. Are we allowed to pray the long salah? So the Prophet ﷺ said, the best religion is the easiest. What does this mean? It is permissible for a person to prolong his salah when he's praying a voluntary salah. But it is not permissible for him to prolong it to the extent that it harms him. And this is why we will find narrations in this kitab later on inshaAllah ta'ala, where the Prophet ﷺ, he enters the house of Hani, and she has a rope coming from the ceiling. So the Prophet ﷺ says, what is this? She said, for me to hold when I am in salah, if I'm going to fall down, I will hold this so I can stand up. So the Prophet ﷺ prohibited her from this. The religion is not supposed to harm you. And voluntary prayers and ibadah is not supposed to harm a person. So the best religion is the easiest. Meaning a person worships Allah Jalla wa'ala according to his ability and he does not harm himself. This is the best religion for a person. And this is why you would find some of the imams of al-Islam that if standing for a long period of time was going to harm them and cause hardship to them, they will stand for shorter periods of time but they will increase their raka'at. So for example, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, when he would pray the night prayer by himself at home, he would pray over 100 raka'at. This was also narrated regarding his student Abu Yusuf al-Ansari. This was narrated also regarding Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And the Salaf, they used to do this. So they used to sometimes stand and pray 100 raka'at in the evening. And you would think to yourself, how can you pray 100 raka'at in the evening? Is it possible? Of course it's possible. If you were to say the night is 6 hours, or 8 hours, or 10 hours, and we were to say one raka'ah is going to take you a minute or 2 minutes. It is possible to stand for 100 raka'ahs in the evening. So if it is going to be difficult for a person to stand for a long period of time, then they would stand for shorter periods of time and they would increase their raka'ahs. And that's why when the Prophet ﷺ was asked about the night prayer, what ma tara fi salatil layl, what do you say about the night prayer? The Prophet ﷺ said, mathna mathna, 2 by 2. He didn't say 2 by 2 until 8. Or 2 by 2 until 20. Or 2 by 2 until 36. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, mathna mathna, 2 by 2. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to perform 8. And when Umar radiallahu anhu told Tamim radiallahu anhu to lead the people in salah and Ubay, he told him to lead the people in 11. But he did not say it is haram for you to extend. And this is why we find from the A'immat al-Arba'ah, from the four Imams of al-Islam, they all increased on this to the extent that Imam Malik used to perform 36 raka'ah for salatul tarawih and qiyamul layl. So a person, he should not cause hardship upon himself and burden himself when he is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He should do that which is easy for him. And if it is difficult for him to stand for long periods of time, he should lessen his standing and then increase his raka'at and increase the amount that he prays. And this is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a person harming himself. No.
حدثنا حجاج قال حدثنا حماد بن سلمة عن علي بن زيد عن عبد الرحمن بن بكر عن الأسود بن سليم قال أتيت النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم فقلت يا رسول الله قد مدحت الله بمحامد ومدح وإياك فقال أما إن ربك يحب الحمد فجعلت أنشده فاستأذن رجل طوال أصبح فقال لي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اسكت فدخل فتكلم ساعة ثم خرج فأنشدته فانشده ثم جاء فسكتني ثم خرج فعل ذلك مرتين او ثلاثا فقلت من هذا الذي سكتني له قال هذا رجل لا يحب الباطل.
Now Imam al-Bukhari begins a new chapter. He says, "Babu man madaha fi shi'r," the chapter of the one who praises in poetry. And the reason why Imam al-Bukhari specified poetry for this chapter is because the poets are known to excessively praise. And even till today we find. Sometimes we will find poets that go to ulama and say, "I have made a poem about you, can I say it in your presence?" And the majority of the time you tell, the ulama will say, "No, do not say it in front of me and do not narrate it." Because they do not want to be excessively praised, because it will even damage them, even though they are ulama. So Imam al-Bukhari says, "Babu man madaha fi shi'r," the chapter of the one who praises in poetry. Then he mentions the hadith of Al-Aswad ibn Sariq, radiyallahu anhu. In the chain of narration is Ali ibn Zayd, and he is da'if, and therefore the hadith is da'if. The hadith is, أَتَيْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقُلْتُ I came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and I said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ O Messenger of Allah, قَدْ مَدَحْتُ اللَّهَ بِمَحَامِدَ وَمِدَحْ وَإِيَّاكَ I have praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with praises and also yourself. فَقَالَ So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أَمَا إِنَّ رَبَّكَ يُحِبُّ الْحَمْدِ As for your Lord, he loves to be praised. فَجَعَلْتُ أُنْشِدُهُ So I began to mention this poem in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَاسْتَأْذَنَ رَجُلٌ طُوَالٌ أَصْلَعٌ A man, he sought permission to enter and he was very tall and he was bald. فَقَالَ لِلنَّبِيُّ sallallahu alaihi wasallam So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, أُسْكُتْ Be quiet. Meaning he told the person to stop saying the poetry. فَدَخَلَ فَتَكَلَّمَ سَاعَةً ثُمَّ خَرَجْ This man, he entered, he spoke for a period of time and then he left. فَأَنْشَدْتُهُ Then I began to say the poetry again. ثُمَّ جَاءَ فَسَكَّتَنِي ثُمَّ خَرَجْ Then this man came again, so the Prophet ﷺ told me to be quiet, and then he left. فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ مَرَّتَيْنِ أَوْ ثَلَاثًا The Prophet ﷺ did this, or this happened two or three times. فَقُلْتُ مَنْ هَذَا الَّذِي سَكَّتَنِي لَهُ The man, he said, who is this person that you told me to be quiet because of? The Prophet ﷺ said, هَذَا رَجُلٌ لَا يُحِبُّ الْبَاطِلِ This is a person who does not like falsehood. This is a person who does not like falsehood. And this man was Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. So the hadith is da'if, because in the chain is Ali ibn Zayd. And some of the ulama mentioned that the hadith is also da'if because of the matan as well. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would listen to falsehood and he would be quiet and he would not want the falsehood to be recited or mentioned in front of Umar ibn Khattab. So this is why some of the muhaddithun, they have also said, and the matan, the text of the hadith is also da'if. And other ulama say, no, the text of the hadith is not da'if. The text of the hadith can be accepted, even though the chain is weak. And why is this? Because what is intended by batil here, falsehood, is not that which is haram. Is that which is not recommended. So in the sharia we have fadil and we have mafdul. We have that which is preferred, and that which is permissible, but it is not the best thing to do. So the ulama, they mentioned that out of the rahmah the Prophet ﷺ had, he would even listen to people if they were doing permissible acts, but were not the best acts. So he could have done dhikr of Allah and reciting Quran, but instead he was reciting poetry. So reciting poetry, if there is no haram in it, is it permissible? Yes, it's permissible. But is it better than reciting the Quran and doing dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala? No. So they said, out of the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ, he would listen to people who were doing mafdul, who were doing just the permissible things, because he wanted to draw their hearts to Islam. But as for Umar ibn Khattab, he always wanted the best thing to be implemented in front of him. So when he came, the Prophet ﷺ said, don't say it in front of him, because this will make him angry. It doesn't mean Umar is better than the Prophet ﷺ, no. It means the Prophet ﷺ was dealing with his companions in a way that would bring them to Islam and soften their hearts. So if we say the hadith is authentic, then there is no problem in accepting the matan, the text, if we understand it in this way. And if we say the hadith is da'if, then if we understand the text in this way, there is nothing that prohibits us from accepting this text. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا سليمان قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن ابي عبد الرحمن بن ابي بكر عن الاسود بن سريع قلت للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومدحتك ومدحت الله عز وجل
And now Imam al-Bukhari, he mentions this narration with another chain, but also in this hadith, in the chain is Ali ibn Zayd, who is da'if. And the wording was slightly different in this hadith. It said, مَدَحْتُكَ وَمَدَحْتُ اللَّهِ I praised you, and I praised Allah. And this has already been explained in the previous hadith.